Hello, and welcome to our TI Precision Labs Audio Fundamentals video. We will be going over the choices of different capacitors when looking to capture analog audio signals for conversion to digital. We are going to introduce the different types of the most widely used capacitors and cover the pros and cons of each, give an overview of what contributes to the different attributes, and help guide you in making the right choice in capacitor for your audio input applications. The most popular capacitors are ceramics, which use high dielectric materials to get the majority of its capacitance, along with using a multi-layer structure, so they are often abbreviated as MLCCs and are divided into two classes. These are followed by electrolytic capacitors that make use of the oxides of metals like aluminum and tantalum, along with its curled plating structure to create capacitance and make the majority of them appear as cylindrical towers. Then, there are film capacitors that are much like the ceramics in terms of structure but are often bulkier due to the lack of high dielectric materials. Capacitors, to put it simply, are large areas of conductive material separated by a very tiny distance. And when we talk about dielectric material, we are talking about what material is in between that distance. Dielectric materials raise capacitance due to tiny shifts in charge within that material to become polarized and accommodate more charge on the conductive sheets they are in between, without actually conducting any current in a stable electric field. We define dielectric by its K value, which is a unitless value showing the ratio of the permittivity of that material to that of a vacuum. The higher the K, the bigger the capacitance you can create, which also allows you to reduce area and subsequently overall size. Here is a chart of commonly used dielectric materials. These materials can be broken down to what type of capacitors they are used for. The first six are usually found in thin film capacitors, showing how low the K values used are in comparison to other three types, especially that of class II ceramic capacitors. The first class of multilayer ceramic capacitors often use paraelectric materials, which are materials that have a specific quality of becoming non-linearly polarized with an applied electric field. This makes for good K values, but a lack of consistency when the electric field changes in amplitude. This is an inherent problem to use these types of capacitors in audio applications, as lower frequency signals will raise the impedance of the capacitor, creating a larger voltage drop in a larger field, which causes the capacitance to change, which then distorts the lower frequency signals as compared to higher frequency. As you can see in the diagram, in the bottom left, the capacitor structures are interlaced sheets separated by some type of dielectric material represented by the orange. In the case of class 1 ceramics, the material is often variations of titanium oxide doped with strontium titanite. Class 2 ceramic capacitors are very similar to class 1 type, except it uses even higher K material known as barium titanite. While the higher K is great, it also shares the same problem of the applied voltage varying the capacitance, as well as now having a heavier temperature dependency on its K value. It is ferroelectric material versus paraelectric, meaning it will distort even more for lower frequencies, as well as over time the substance will become permanently polarized, which degrades the quality of the capacitor. While you can make them really tiny, they are not often the best choice due to these numerous variables at play. As we see in the black line on the graph in the top right, the ceramic capacitors get high levels of distortion at lower frequencies because of increased impedance, which causes an increased voltage drop and consequently a change in capacitance. A solution to minimize this effect is to simply add more input resistance to the recording terminal so the voltage drop is taken up more by the resistors rather than the capacitor, which you can clearly see works to a point when observing the higher impedance put into the circuit, the more shifted to the left the line becomes. The drawbacks of this include lower signal-to-noise ratio and more gain error produced within the preamps in some of our audio ADCs. Alternatively, instead of increasing resistance, you could just increase the capacitor to be large enough that the impedance does not start rising and creating distortion until the lowest frequencies are observed. This is because impedance is inversely proportional to both frequency and capacitance. The graph to the left is similar to the one on the previous slide, but with a raise in capacitance and not overall impedance, though the intermingling lines make it a less reliable approach until super high capacitors are used. The graph to the right also shows how the higher capacitance, the less distortion there is for high amplitude signals, which is a big plus. Electrolytic capacitors are great because they still use decently high K materials but are not subject to nearly as much change in impedance or distortion, as long as you correctly apply a DC bias. The symbol in the top right is that of specifically electrolytic capacitors, since in a DC environment they work only in one direction, and in the case of AC, the distortion will be minimized when that correct DC bias is applied, as proven by the chart when comparing the dotted versus solid red and blue lines. The unique structure of this type of capacitor has to do with how the dielectric is grown by oxidizing the terminal metals versus sandwiching material from different sources between layered metal plates. We can start off by looking at the chart once again, where we see the green line, the film capacitor, shows no inflated levels of distortion at all when it comes to lower frequencies, which creates a huge quality difference when comparing it to the black line, representing classic ceramic capacitors. There is also no need for any applied bias, and the structure can be similar to that of ceramic. The catch is the fact if you want a sizable capacitance like 47 microfarad, there will need to be quite a chunk of space on your PCB for the capacitor to fit. This is because the low dielectric requires more overlapping area, which means size differences that can be orders of magnitude compared to ceramics. Whenever low voltage coefficient capacitors are mentioned, they are often talking about film capacitors due to their independence of the applied field on its capacitance. Here we can take a quick summary of what we have gone over, and see how each of the capacitor types vary, and that it is clearly an evident trade-off between high K material and the size of the capacitor. The required compensation need for each to be usable for audio must also be taken into account, as well as relative pricing. Important things to keep in mind is size, required extra compensation, and material used for determining what quality of capacitor fits your application. We spent a lot of time going over ceramic capacitors, and while there are ways to make them work, if you are looking for high quality audio recordings, you need to look more at either using electrolytic or film capacitors. Preferably film capacitors would be the best, but not practical when the capacitance needed for the application is too large, which would make electrolytic the better choice, given you would need to bias it correctly. To see the ADC evaluation modules used to create the data shown, or need more help in determining the best option for you, please see these references. Thank you for watching our video, and hope we have helped you in making the right decision in your audio application.